everyone who's joining this broadcast remotely. I want to begin by acknowledging that we are broadcasting to you from the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Musqueam people. And I recognize that the lands affected by the recent natural disasters in British Columbia belong to those many different First Nations. My name is James Olson. I'm a professor in mechanical engineering and dean of the Faculty of Applied Science at UBC on both campuses. I want to thank the UBC team of civil and geotechnical engineers that are presenting and sharing their analysis and insights here today. This includes Drs. Fannin, Kim, McDougall, Weijs, Wijewickreme. I also want to thank everyone who's led the organization of today's events. The climate events that took place last month and the resulting catastrophic failure of civil infrastructure, the loss of lives, homes, livelihoods, raises serious questions that need to be answered. It raises questions as to the adequacy and preparedness of our current infrastructure. It raises questions about climate change and the need to adapt our infrastructure for an uncertain future. It raises questions about the educational research and innovation response of universities to meet the challenge of climate adaptation. It raises questions on how do we design, plan, and engineer resilient and equitable cities and communities for the future. A question that is right at the core of what we do across all of the professions that are in the Faculty of Applied Science at UBC. I recognize that today we are just now moving from crisis response to the initial rebuilding of critical dikes, roads, bridges, railways, and that these questions will take time to answer, and that we are just at the start of that journey. I'm very much looking forward to today's briefing and to join with our partners in government and industry to take real action towards building more resilient and equitable cities and communities to the benefit of all British Columbians. Thank you all for joining us today. And I will now pass to our moderator this morning for this morning's session, Dr. Nemy Banthia.
Thank you very much, James. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Nemy Banthia, and I serve as a professor of civil engineering here at UBC, and I will be your moderator for this session today. Welcome to the technical briefing on the major flooding and landslides we just witnessed in British Columbia. Although it happened at the end of November, we'll continue to endure its effects for a very long time to come. There is an indigenous saying that says, man may desperately try to control Mother Nature, but Mother Nature always has its own plans. BC floods that we just endured are now Canada's most costly natural disaster ever, with $32 billion estimated in economic losses. Before this, Canada's most expensive natural disaster was the wildfires in Fort McMurray that led to $3.7 billion in insurance claims. Damage to our infrastructure has been enormous. Highway bridges have to be replaced, sections of rail lines to be relaid, and entire communities need to be resettled. Thousands of homes have been destroyed, and nearly 70% of the region's dikes have succumbed. Our natural resource industry that we depend so much on, like forestry, agriculture, fishing, minerals, natural gas, and hydroelectricity, have also been affected badly, with huge economic losses and supply management challenges. Insurance Bureau of Canada recommends halting all new developments in the floodplains. Now, beyond the loss of physical infrastructure and economic activity, floods also have a human price to pay. The calamitous effect on people, their health, their mental well-being, and not just that, our ecological system and our cultural heritage. A lot was lost at the end of November. At this session, five of our world-renowned specialists will provide technical insights on rainfall and river flows, flood risk management, slope stability and debris flow, erosion and dike failures, impact on pipelines, geohazard risk management, and of course, a major disruption that we all noticed to our transportation networks. I will now ask our first speaker to come to the podium. Please join me in welcoming Professor Amy Kim. Thank you.
So as we know, the November storms has had and will continue to have enormous impacts to our civil infrastructure, which in turn affects nearly all sectors of society in BC and well beyond. Homes and agriculture have been directly impacted by flooding. In terms of the transportation system, there has been extensive catastrophic damage to the infrastructure in the Fraser Valley, interior BC, and Vancouver Island. This has resulted in highway and rail closures and advisories, in turn resulting in massive delays, evacuations, supply chain disruptions, and limited to no access to some communities along these routes. Also, the storm and its impacts led to a precautionary temporary shutdown of the Trans Mountain Pipeline, as well as many community evacuation alerts and orders. So to get a sense of the scale of the impacts of the storm on the transportation system, I'll play this video showing Southern BC, including the island, and all the major closures and advisories on provincial as well as some municipal facilities from November 14th through December 2nd. So November 14th is when the travel advisories and evacuation alerts started, and the Trans Mountain Pipeline went into a precautionary shutdown. On November 15th, there was a point in time during which there was not a single open route connecting the Lower Mainland and interior BC, and thus the rest of Canada, by either rail or road, isolating the country's largest port, the Port of Vancouver. November 15th is also when the evacuation orders began. Please note that this video only covers up to and including December 2nd, and conditions have continued to change rapidly since then. However, we are firmly in the repair and recovery phase. CP rail tracks were back in service on November 23rd, while CN rail tracks were reopened on December 5th. The Trans Mountain Pipeline was also safely restarted on December 5th. As of last week, many highway routes were operational again, except Highways 99, 8, and 5, or the Coquihalla Highway, and some routes in the Sumas Prairie neighborhood of Abbotsford. The highway sections that remain closed are, of course, those that sustained some of the greatest structural damage. Now, as you are likely aware, there are major consequences resulting from the ongoing route closures, and I will highlight a couple. First, they result in the loss of primary ground access for small communities along these routes, which include many First Nations. For some communities, the only remaining means of connectivity become air and sometimes river transport, and potentially rough logging routes not meant for such purposes. Second, those that would normally use closed routes, like the Coquihalla, will reroute if an alternate is available, in this case, Highway 3. Now, Highway 3 remains designated for essential travel only while repairs continue on the Coquihalla. Because the sole alternate route is not meant to accommodate this much traffic, nor allows for the same speeds as on the Coquihalla, there are safety concerns which bear out in traffic incidents and collisions. In fact, this last Sunday, Highway 3 between Hope and Princeton was closed for several hours due to heavy snow and a resulting collision. Already disrupted supply chains are impacted further and people can be injured. Overall, there's widespread prolonged damage to the highways and other civil infrastructure, and the risks continue on this heavily distressed landscape, in turn leaving communities and the transportation system vulnerable to further disruptions. So with that, I will turn it over to my colleagues who will speak to this and the physical processes that result in the heavy damage we are witnessing.
Thank you, Amy. As Dr. Kim mentioned, if we look into the physical processes that caused this disaster, we have to actually start in the atmosphere. In the global circulation, there's a continuous large-scale flux of moisture and heat from the tropics to the higher latitudes to balance the equilibrium in net radiation. And sometimes this transport takes the form of atmospheric rivers, which are narrow bands of moisture that flow from tropical regions to higher latitudes with high moisture content and warm air. And if we keep the analogy with the river, you can imagine that the flux of moisture that we get is the multiplication of the width, the depth, and the velocity of the river. These rivers meander, and sometimes they stay for a longer period of time focused on one spot. So for the depth of this atmospheric river, we could look at precipitable water, which is basically the water column contained in the column of atmosphere. That's depicted in this remote sensing imagery from satellites. And here we see the mid-November event unfolding, where large amounts of moisture were brought to the BC coast and intercepted by the coastal mountains. In the coastal mountains, we got orography, so the effect of mountains lifting air, causing condensation, also releasing heat.
Recording in progress.
On top of that, the antecedent moisture that accumulated over the 2 months preceding the event, which you can see depicted on the top left, is in the 98th percentile for many locations in BC. So we had a situation of high antecedent moisture, and then also the events around mid-November were above the 98th percentile. I must say that rain gauges are relatively scarce in this region, so we have to use radar and other remote sensing products to really investigate the magnitude of this event in terms of rainfall. Apart from rainfall, these atmospheric rivers also bring a lot of heat into the system. And for some regions, this event was a rain on snow event, which are notorious for causing flooding. So some of the heat inputs to the snowpack during this atmospheric river event include the heat affected by the precipitation. So precipitation at about 10 degrees Celsius could cause about 15% extra millimeters of runoff on top of the snow, on top of the rainfall event itself. There's sensible heat transfer by the warm, turbulent air and high wind speeds to the snowpack. And there's heat by long wave radiation, which is depicted on the right side. Warmer air and more moist air causes more radiation inputs to the snowpack. We really have to investigate this in detail to understand these type of events better. Now, if we look at Merritt, which is one example of a upstream town that was affected by the flooding, similar events happened in Princeton and many First Nation communities. We see this antecedent moisture, precipitation, and snowmelt all conspiring to bring these high flow events. But on top of that, we can see from this imagery, a large part of the catchment was affected by burns. So this is based on satellite products that give the burnt area for the last summer. And this caused increased runoff, faster runoff, less infiltration, contributing to the flood event. So if we look at the flood event itself, the volume of under the flood peak amounts to about 43 millimeters of water column over the whole catchment, which is a bit higher than the rainfall registered in Merritt. So there are several factors contributing, like higher rainfall upstream and this snowmelt. But then if we look at the peak flow that occurred, 400 cubic meters per second, based on past statistics, you would say that's about a 1 in 2,000 year event. However, taking that new data point into account, this return period will become much lower. And especially if we also take into account that we live in a non-stationary climate, quite probable that what we saw has a much lower return period, and we should be prepared for that. So with that, I'll turn it over to my colleague.
We've heard from colleagues on the nature of the spatial and temporal impact across our infrastructure network. And we've learned of these atmospheric rivers, the quantity of precipitation that they deliver. And they deliver it on a landscape that has antecedent moisture and the potential, especially with the thermal influence, the rising temperatures as these storms come through, that there's snow melt combining with the precipitation on these antecedent very wet grounds. And the question of whether or not wildfire influences on the landscape. And that takes us through to an interest in landslides and especially risk management of landslides. And in the course of this technical briefing, with those introductory remarks on the impacts on the infrastructure, those introductory remarks on the precipitation and the river flows, now we'll move through from observations of their impact into the way some of the engineering science observations, data-driven observations that we acquire through our research, often in collaboration with government partners and industry stakeholders. And we'll try to give insights as to what influences the way we think when we look at the events that have taken place on the landscape. The landslide risk management, moving up the Upper Fraser Valley here, flying over Seabird Island and approaching one of the very significant debris flows. The way in which we would look at this, and in fact, the way in which the profession seeks to deal with it with from a perspective of risk management, is one of what's the likelihood it's going to occur, the probability of occurrence, what kind of chance is there an event is going to start on the hill slope? If it does, what's the likelihood it's going to travel down that hill slope and reach a certain point of interest? Here we're looking at Highway 7. What's the chance that if it starts, it's going to travel all the way down the hill slope? And then if we throw in the temporal effect, what's the chance, for example, that a vehicle be traversing the road at that time? Or if we go beyond and further through the debris flow, for example, the CP rail line is just beyond the terminal lobe of the debris flow, what's the chance that a train would be traversing the track at that point in time? All of that bundles together into what we call debris flow risk management. On the left here, you see a classic image of our coastal terrain, hints of snow and the potential for snow melt. And on the right-hand image, you see a burned subcatchment to a watershed. These are some of the contributing factors that we're recognizing through this technical briefing. And they're recognized by others. We've already had people on the ground in the late summer, early fall, trying to make wildfire assessments on landslide-prone terrain. And here's the impact. If it occurs, what is the chance it's going to travel down? What is the impact on the road system? On the left image, the Coquihalla, one of the lanes blocked by a debris flow that has come down and started to impact, not too badly, I'd say. Middle image, a little bit more significant. A debris flow has come down. It's traversed the railway track close to Nickerman and over Highway 1, depositing into the Thompson River. And on the right-hand side, we see a very extreme, close by, the Tankill underpass. And in fact, evidence there both of a debris flow from the materials on the road and torrenting river flow continuing in the event. And moving to close on these observations on the ground and to what influences the way we think when we look at them. Trans Mountain Pipeline here, debris flows that have come down, impacted, overridden the right of way. It raises questions about removal of ground cover. It raises questions that we'll address coming up in the technical briefing on aspects of pipeline deformation. And the right-hand image summarizes most of what we would really like to speak to from an informed point of view, which is how large is the event going to be? What's the magnitude of the event? And will its travel distance take it down to impact the road or the pipeline crossing here of the Coquihalla River? So now moving towards research study insights, often done in this case in partnership with Metro Vancouver, a lot of work that I've done with the Ministry of Forests over the years. We go in and on the left-hand image, the circle is highlighting not November 2021, but November 1990. It takes us back. The first time I went up to this site was following a storm, 22nd, 23rd of November 1990. This area of the watershed receives over 3,000 millimeters of rain annually. The maximum 24-hour precipitation is greater than 300 millimeters. And this site, this cut block at the back of the Seymour watershed, received much more than that rainfall. And it triggered the debris flow that you see on the left-hand image. The right-hand image highlights that, and in green highlights another one. And this gives us a sense of the legacy that we have on the landscape, both from logging, from wildfire, from the extreme rainfall, extraordinary rainfall that some of these events deliver. And they're very mobile. They'll travel down the open slope and they may get channelized. And as they get channelized, They're bringing with them the volume of material, in this case, 5,000 meters cubed or so, that was coming down the hill slope. And if we look at the graphic on the left, there's a depiction of the hill slope. We see the initial volumes. They're very small, the little columns on the x-axis. They're very small, but they all add up. These events in train, and we've seen these in databases from the Queen Charlotte Islands. We've seen it when we've developed empirical statistical models, such as UBC D-flow, to model from statistical regression to databases. What happens reach by reach as you move down the debris flow path? And we see events in training material growing in size, and then the red bars on the left-hand graphic, which correspond to the photograph on the right-hand side there, we have these large depositional fans, often on ancestral deposits. And the question then becomes one of the magnitude. And my colleague, who will follow shortly, will speak to tools and techniques that complement these empirical statistical tools, techniques that will complement screening level analyses of the susceptibility to impact. So in my concluding slide here, at this point in the technical briefing, let us return to that event and look at it now with new eyes in terms of the debris that has come down, the fact that it, from its point of origin and upon initiation, it has traveled the full distance as we would likely expect it would do. The debris flow has extended beyond Highway 7, underneath the transmission lines of the BC Hydro line there, and in fact, almost impacted onto the CP rail line, jointly used with CN, by the Fraser River there. The risk management of these debris flows is a key issue. And at this point, I'll turn it over to my colleague to continue with reflections on debris flow risk management.
Thanks, Jonathan. Good morning, everyone. My name is Scott McDougall. I'm an assistant professor in the geological engineering program here at UBC. I'd like to pick up where Jonathan left off and expand on some of his thoughts on the recent landslides and how some of the tools we use and develop here at UBC can be used as we move forward. I'd also like to highlight some of the key challenges we face as engineers and geoscientists involved in this work. And on that note, I'd also like to give a shout out to all the engineers and geoscientists out there who've been working around the clock on the recovery efforts since mid-November. As Amy and Jonathan both said, a number of landslides impacted highways and other linear infrastructure during the November events. The photos here were actually taken by one of my students, who was stuck between the landslides on Highway 7 near Agassiz and had to spend a night in his car before getting a helicopter ride out. I think every landslide professional in the province was holding their breath the morning of November 15th. And while receiving these photos was cool, having a student directly involved in these events hit pretty close to home. In the news, we hear about mudslides, which is basically a catch-all term for landslides involving soil. Jonathan highlighted an especially damaging type of landslide here known as a debris flow. Historically, debris flows are the most deadly type of landslide in BC. They're also a relatively unique type of landslide because we have a good idea where they're going to occur from time to time in steep creek channels. They may start as shallow failures on watershed slopes or by remobilization of loose debris within a channel, but either way, they tend to find their way to the main creek channel. Once they reach the watershed outlet, they may continue to follow the active creek channel, but they can sometimes jump out of their channel and take a new path. In this way, depositional landforms known as fans are formed over time. These landforms are crossed by linear infrastructure and are often sites of residential development. When debris flows occur, we try to learn as much as we can, starting by identifying source locations and mapping impact areas. Historically, air photos have been an important tool for these purposes, but high-resolution satellite imagery is increasingly useful. The two satellite images shown here are an area up the Fraser Valley near Mount Cheam. The one on the left was taken in late October, before the recent events, while the one on the right was taken after. Unfortunately, the image on the right is the only cloud-free image available for this area since mid-November, and most of the slope is caught in a morning shadow, making it challenging to identify changes due to slope movements. But if you zoom in and squint, you can see them. On a site-specific scale, several field mapping methods are available, including drones. The drone shown in the photo on the left carries a laser scanner and is named after the highly respected local geologist, Bob Garath. This scanner allows us to collect really high resolution topographic data. By analyzing sequential scans, we can detect changes that have occurred between scan dates. This information can be used to get accurate estimates of debris flow volumes, as well as to identify patterns in debris flow deposition. The image on the far right is a composite of multiple debris flow impact areas that have been mapped on the same fan, in this case dating back to 1946, using a combination of all the methods I've just described. The patterns we identify help us develop predictive models that can be used for site-specific risk assessment and mitigation design. The image on the left is a heat map generated by scaling and then superimposing 146 debris flow impact areas that were mapped on 30 different fans in southwestern BC. It shows that debris flows in this region tend to follow the path of previous debris flows down their fan, but sometimes they can surprise us and diverge from those expected paths. To help understand where those diversions are most likely to occur on a specific fan, we can use numerical models. The animation that just ran on the right shows a computer simulation of a debris flow using a model that was developed here at UBC. In addition to helping us predict potential impact areas, these types of models also give us information about potential flow depths and velocities. That information can then be used in the design of mitigation. Mitigation can take different forms, ranging from avoidance to structural protection. There's precedent for the use of large mitigation structures here in BC, especially along the Sea to Sky corridor, where a similar series of debris flows caused extensive damage in the 1980s. These types of structures are also used around the world, but they tend to be expensive, so it's not practical to build them everywhere, and tough decisions need to be made. Risk assessment methods are sometimes used to inform these types of decisions. Landslide risk evaluation practice is evolving in BC, but broadly applicable guidance on tolerable levels of landslide safety does not exist yet. A bit of new guidance is expected with an update to EGBC's professional practice guidelines next year. In the meantime, research is underway to develop new tools that can improve communication and decision-making, including tools for cost-benefit analysis. Prioritization of mitigation sites is a key challenge when it comes to linear infrastructure, which can cross a large number of different hazard zones, and as we saw in November, involving a number of different hazard types. These photos are the same area near Mount Cheam that was shown in a previous slide. Another challenge that's evident in these photos is the interaction of multiple stakeholders in the same corridor, all with different interests and resources. You can see that these debris flows have impacted a railway, a highway, a hydro transmission line, and a pipeline right-of-way. And with that, I'll turn things over to Dharma to talk about pipeline impacts.
Thank you, Scott. Good morning. I'm Dharma Wijewickreme. My colleagues gave a good overview about natural hazards. I will spend a few minutes looking at pipeline impacts. I'd like to start with two schematics to show some key impacts on pipelines. Ground movements is a key hazard to pipelines. As shown on the left, soil forces from landslides could pull the pipelines, or sometimes they could push them sideways. On the other hand, when crossing rivers, soil erosion can occur and expose the pipe. As shown on the right, the exposed pipe can get impacted by water forces and make it vibrate, and it could lead to fatigue type of failures. The other problem is debris hitting directly on the pipe. All these impacts can dent, deform, strain the pipes, and sometimes leading to rupture, which is not a good thing. I would like to take a quick look at the information available from Trans Mountain. Some parts of the pipeline was exposed during rainfall and got impacted by flooding and debris. Seems that the impacts were mainly in the way of coating damages and external dents. You can see the Trans Mountain photos I extracted from the website showing soil protection and pipeline repairs undergoing. The pipeline is now back in operation after a precautionary shutdown. One of the things I want to highlight is we can learn a lot from past case histories. Considering the time we have, I'm going to take a couple of examples. On the left side is a photo from a Red Deer River flooding in 2012. The pipeline failed due to high cyclic loading from the free water forces hitting on the unsupported pipeline, led to an oil spill. On the other hand, an event from Peru, again, the pipeline got pulled down, got exposed, but thankfully, it didn't fail. It was actually a 92-meter unsupported span. So you can see that these things can go either way. So how does a failed pipe look like? Well, there are many ways, but some typical scenarios are tensile failure, as shown on the left, in the middle, buckling, and of course, on the right-hand side is bending type of failure. So in addition to these type of failures, the other important part, which is corrosion protection, can also get affected. So it's a big, complex problem. At this point, I think I'm going to invite Dr. Fannin to continue.
My colleague was speaking to integrity of pipeline systems. And these are one of a series of systems, both transportation, pipeline related, and from flood control works. Then we have a dike system. And I'm going to just speak to a few things that we saw and to try and put them in context of both current practice and what influences the way we think in terms, once again, of having to return to risk management and decision-making, both in the face of uncertainty and decision-making in the face of data gaps. On the matter of the dike integrity, we followed in the media the progression from evacuation alerts to evacuation orders, and did so with particular focus on the Sumas Ferry floodplain. The dike system is elaborate, and in fact, there are many hundreds of dikes in the lower mainland of British Columbia. The flood event caused breaches. This is one of those breaches that we see along the interceptor dike. Those breaches led to the catastrophic flooding that we now are bearing the cost of, and for many people, their livelihoods very significantly impacted. Following that dike along towards the Sumas River, we see other impacts. On the left-hand image, erosion of material on the land side of the dike. In the middle photograph, further erosion on the landslide of the dike. And then on the right-hand image, we're following through to the location of the very significant breach and its reconstruction. In fact, there's a combination of rehabilitation, reconstruction, and a lot of assessment ongoing as we speak. The reconstruction was brought to us. And we see examples here of both the nature of the dike and some of the challenges in bringing them back up to suitable crest levels to reinstate protection. Issues of flooding have hit the headlines, not just in British Columbia, but they've also hit the headlines over the last 10 to 20 years in the United Kingdom, in Germany, France, and Belgium. In France, it has received a lot of attention. And I'll shout out to the International Levee Handbook, a decision that was taken within Europe to try and pull together advice. And I think some of the confidence in decision-making moving forward is going to be informed by work that is done in other jurisdictions, so that we're not taking and defending decisions in solely by our experience in British Columbia. The processes that lead to breach are complex, and they involve deterioration that programs of maintenance and inspection will be seeking to catch, such that damage during the flood event itself will not necessarily lead to catastrophic breaching. The nature of those processes that lead to failure relate to external erosion, internal erosion, and slope stability. Processes of external erosion, depicted in the images on the left there, are evident in the photograph on the right in terms of some of the rehabilitation works that we can see, the repairs to the dike system that are ongoing at the moment. The failure processes for internal erosion, I'd like to take a moment to talk about those. They are rising up the agenda, not only of those working in the dike community, but also those working in the embankment dam community, a recognition that the risk associated with internal erosion, the cartoon image on the top right-hand side, once again taken from the International Levee Handbook, but equally applicable in the embankment dams world, shows internal erosion within the embankment. But then there's also the question of internal erosion within the foundations. And if we look south of the border to some of the work that's being undertaken by the US Bureau of Reclamation, amongst others, the information that's being collected, statistics that are being collected, inform on the probability and the likelihoods and the forms that the internal erosion can take. The cartoon image on the left, we're working to further develop that. I've taken it from work that we have published in the ICOLD, International Commission on Large Dams. The ICOLD bulletin came out in 2019, speaking to tools and techniques to evaluate the risk of internal erosion. Those risks are being addressed by advanced laboratory testing, such as the images that you see here, conducted in UBC. We're partnering with colleagues in Europe in this work. There's a European working group that we're closely aligned with, and conducting tests to try and bring a mechanics-based understanding to these processes to assist with the risk management of the phenomenon. Dike failure statistics are a part and parcel of complementing the advanced laboratory testing, the tools and techniques that we need to make informed, risk-based decisions in the face of uncertainty, must address both an appreciation for case precedents, as was acknowledged by my colleague on the pipelines, and international approaches to managing that risk, as my colleague will speak to next. And it's a complex interplay. We recognize that internal erosion may cause the dike system to deteriorate. Combinations of internal erosion and external erosion will deteriorate it further over the life, over a long period of the dike that must be caught with maintenance and must be addressed by assessments and repair to prevent the kind of damage that leads to the breaches, and internal erosion, external erosion interplaying that may lead to soap stability and the failure. And we see this in events in the United Kingdom, flooding that impacted over 1,000 kilometers of dikes, significant overtopping. When the investigations were carried out after the fact, as was necessarily done, in fact, it transpired there were only 4 breaches across that whole system, but causing enormous damage. And it was determined that those breaches actually took place before the final overtopping of the dikes in 3 of the 4 instances. So it's very important that we take the opportunity now to learn about how the dike system has responded to make sure that we have informed decisions moving forward. At this point, I'll turn it to my colleague to build upon the flood risk management issues.
Thank you, Jonathan. Yes, so next to the geotechnical mechanisms for failure for dikes, another important part to understand is the hydraulic loading. And there are some interactions that are there. So, for example, if a dike breaches or an area floods, that could reduce water levels and cause the dike not to breach in other locations. So that could work to our advantage. On the other hand, there's things that are very unpredictable, like the buildup of large woody debris, as you can see here against this bridge, which could increase water levels and cause unexpected overtopping. So taking into account all those failure mechanisms is important to have a total probability of failure on a system level. So in the Netherlands, where I grew up, there has been a large body of work, risk assessment on a large spatial scale, which is necessary to build priorities for building flood protection. So this was mostly in response to a very catastrophic flood event in the 50s. This led to a, a risk-based approach where, based on cost-benefit analysis, it was calculated that it made sense economically to protect some areas against floods with return periods of over 1,000 years. As you can see in the figure on the left, some areas have protection levels up to 10,000 years. This was prior to 2016. Just before 2016, a large-scale study studied the economical risk for the current state of the dike system, taking into account all these different failure mechanisms. So you can see in this picture, there's this dike ring. And for each dike section, based on the stability and the expected hydraulic conditions, failure probabilities are calculated. And then for each of the possible breach locations, effects in terms of flooding of the surrounding land and economical impacts and risks to life are simulated. And to do this on a large scale, that allows us to prioritize between different measures. It also allows us to do a cost-benefit analysis for the whole system. And it turns out that often the economic requirements for optimal flood risk protection are stricter than the ones for safety, interestingly enough. But that could vary per location. So this is a good tool to estimate and identify cost-effective measures. Another thing that's important is if you look at the river as a spatial planning element, we have to make sure that there's enough capacity to bring the water from upstream to the ocean. So that requires to a level of spatial planning where the river is central. So in the Netherlands, there was a project called Room for the River, where the whole floodplain was analyzed in terms of possible obstructions to flow, with many measures recommended, such as secondary flow channels, lowering of the floodplains in some areas, removal of obstacles. So this doesn't only bring down the flood risk locally because of the bringing down of water levels, but it also creates storage, which attenuates the flood wave and makes it dissipate, so you get lower peak flows downstream. Yeah, so I think in summary, under a non-stationary situation, as you can see on the top left, there's a continuous growth in all kinds of natural disaster risks. This comes from reinsurance companies. We have to continuously update our risk analysis and decide where to prioritize. What makes it difficult is that the boundary conditions are changing. So there's this trends in the climate. We really need to monitor. So I would also call for an expansion of monitoring networks. That's what my research group is working on in deciding where to prioritize monitoring. And another promising avenue of research is using machine learning models that directly take in remote sensing data to make better predictions. So with that, I would like to turn it over to my colleague who speaks about pipeline.
Thank you, Stephen. One of the things that you probably would have noticed is the geohazard problem and its consequences. Altogether, it's a very complex problem. I thought of extracting this qualitative graph from one of our research papers. The biggest thing I want to highlight here is the very high uncertainty in estimating ground movements. So as geotechnical engineers, we always face this problem, and it's way more difficult compared to the uncertainty that we have, for example, in defining the pipeline capacity. So this is a big challenge, and probably that's why we are not able to come up with what we call as firm solutions. And I'm going to go over a few of the methodologies that people have been using to mitigate pipeline hazards in particular. So how do we address this complex problem? A lot of factors to address in assessing the integrity of a pipeline. And based on the information available, PRCI 2009 guideline, Pipeline Research Council International guideline, gives very good guidance. The guideline provides pipeline integrity management strategies, for example, to assess ground displacements, which is the difficult one, methods for mitigation, And we need to monitor pipelines and ground displacements both if you want to achieve success on this front. So I'm going to just take a quick look at what are the mitigation alternatives, for example, we have. We can isolate the pipeline from the hazard, we can tolerate the hazard, or we can completely get rid of the hazard. The last option is to relocate away from the hazard. I will also mention that we need to monitor the pipelines. Pipeline monitoring and landslide monitoring forms a key part of finding solutions to this. I want to go over some mitigation examples. For example, you can use geosynthetic wrapping on pipelines to reduce axial loads. What I mean by that is to let the soil slip around the pipe and not put the load on the pipe. If you know that we are on a slope, for example, as shown in the middle cartoon, that might be moving. And if the existing pipeline is in a vulnerable location, we could move the pipe using methods like horizontal directional drilling. Of course, another method is to withstand the forces. Sometimes we achieve that by increasing the pipe wall thickness. These are two examples of completely eliminating the potential hazard. On the left-hand side, this is a project that I worked on when I was in consulting. And what it is we are basically going and densifying the ground, putting good riprap to get rid of the ground movement hazard as well as potential reverse covering. If you look at the picture on the right-hand side, it directly relates to what our previous speakers were talking about, the debris flows, and how do we stop the debris flows directly using barriers. So in order to get all these things optimized, we need to do research because it's a complex problem. And we have been doing a lot of research, particularly on the pipelines at the Pipeline Integrity Institute at UBC. I'll just show you a couple of examples here. For example, one in the middle, it's a video that I have. Hopefully I can play that. It's showing how we analyze look at the forces coming on the pipes when we let the ground move by. Picture on the left-hand side, we are trying to use low-strength backfill materials around the pipes to essentially manage the loads. My colleagues in the materials engineering department, they are working on coating, degradation, corrosion aspects. So we have a lot of work going on. And the intent is to contribute to the profession and the community through this. And as a matter of fact, we are also working on a scour detection device. That the work is underway on that. So with that, I hope that I gave you a bit of a feel for where the pipelines are at and how we are trying to mitigate the problem. With this, I'm going to hand over the floor to Dr. Kim.
Right, thank you, Dharma. All right, so my colleagues have now provided insights into some of the physical processes that can result in damage, failure, and disruptions to our civil infrastructure and assets, speaking specifically to the types of failures and stressors brought on by the recent storms. These impacts occurred over a very large geographic area with many critical transportation corridors, further resulting in extensive transportation operations disruptions and demands over both the short and long term. So let's look at the resulting disruptions mapped over a conceptual timeline of post-disaster infrastructure response phases. After natural disasters, transportation operations depend on whether the infrastructure itself has been impacted, whether communities were impacted, and the severity of these impacts. So initially after the disaster, if the transportation network infrastructure is impacted, reroutes and delays result due to partial or full closures. Alternate routes usually do not offer the same level of service in either way. Network capacity has been reduced. These closures will sometimes cause temporary loss of accessibility, sometimes entirely for some communities. If the communities themselves are impacted by the disaster, acute transportation needs arise with respect to evacuations, as well as mobilization of emergency response and supplies to affected communities. Tactical multimodal coordination to supply as much transportation capacity as possible in a short time frame may be critical to move people and supplies in a timely way. For example, a coordinated ground and air transport effort was critical for evacuating Fort McMurray in 2016. So the point here is that after a disaster, we are seeing acute, intense transportation demands over what is potentially a compromised transportation network. Longer term, into repair and recovery, as well as reconstruction, rerouting will continue as facilities remain less than fully operational and communities may continue to experience limited highway accessibility. Now, as my colleagues have shown, we have a landscape already distressed from wildfires and precipitations, plus there is a spring freshet coming. This brings to mind the term consecutive disasters introduced in a paper from 2020 in Earth's Future, which is defined as, and I quote, events whose impacts overlap both spatially and temporally while recovery is still underway. So in light of these challenges, knowing that we need our transportation network to be more resilient and adaptive to these challenges on our doorstep, we ask ourselves what it means to create such a system. Does it mean to lower the risk for hazards and catastrophic transportation impacts due to these hazards? Does it mean to be better prepared with transportation operations plans when things do fail, or have shorter timeframes to get back to quote unquote normal operations, or perhaps even redefine what we mean by normal as one means of adaptation? In building transportation resilience against extreme weather, we benefit from all these actions, reducing the severity and frequency of physical risks through design, building transportation operations plans that can better support emergency response while providing alternates for necessary travel, and finally, create strategies for improved allocation of limited resources for a range of risk mitigation activities across an existing system, which include assessing the transportation operations impacts of network disruptions. This work is challenging for a number of reasons, two of which I will raise here. First, natural disasters and their impacts are inherently uncertain over time, space, scale, and scope. Second, it can be difficult to relate natural phenomena with detailed transportation operations due to differences in scale as well as data availability. For example, although it is known that severe weather conditions lead to flight delays at northern airports in Canada, it is difficult to demonstrate this using quantitative methods. Excuse me. As a result, most existing adaptation guidelines pertain to hazard-specific mitigation and scenario-based emergency planning, which are site and scenario-specific. On the other end of the spectrum are very broad principles, which can be challenging to implement. As a researcher, I study long-term decision strategies for long-distance transportation systems. In some previous research, I found that when we considered environmental uncertainties as well as the value of flexible decision-making in light of these uncertainties, the balance of a benefit-cost calculation can change. Flexibility in decision-making adds to benefits further in that although benefit-cost analyses may not support certain investments to be made today with prevailing conditions, there may be value in waiting and seeing until a later date. Although this figure and the relationship shown are conceptual, my point is that the benefit-cost relationship may look very different when the benefits of considering changing conditions and doing so in an adaptive manner are included as part of the decision support toolkit.